This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Broadcasting live from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. And now, a guy still not convinced computers are here to stay, Pete Schwaba.
Welcome back to hour number two of this Monday night edition of Nite Lite. So great to have you with me. The texts are rolling in for our question tonight of what is your favorite animated TV show or movie, cartoon, whatever you want to call it, and we will get to those texts soon. Keep them coming, though, folks. Love to read your stuff on the radio. Right now, we're going to play a clip. Yesterday, I had the opportunity to interview Adam Brody. Adam was on the show The OC. That kind of put him on the map, and he is now on a show on Netflix called Nobody Wants This. So he wanted to talk about the canvassing he was doing in Wisconsin, which was awesome, but I used that opportunity to talk a little show business with Adam Brody. Here's that interview.
It's my pleasure to welcome for the first time to Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, actor Adam Brody. Adam, welcome.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you. It's great to have you in Wisconsin. I'll just start with this. You were canvassing today in Madison, I understand, and my niece got to take a picture with you. So she was thrilled about that. That's what I woke up to this morning.
Oh, fantastic. Good. All right. I'm glad.
Yeah.
I hope she was happy.
She was. She said you were a great canvassing partner. Her name is Caroline. So thank you for being hospitable to your fans and to fellow canvassers.
My absolute pleasure.
Yeah. So, all right. So you're in Wisconsin. You're trying to help get out the vote. How's it going so far?
It's going great. I mean, you know, mostly I'm thanking people who are already doing it. You know, I'm just showing my appreciation and my deep gratitude for everyone who's committed their time and effort and braved the, you know, it can be intimidating, I know, because I've done it, to knock on doors, as simple as that sounds. But, you know, there's a threshold you pass, and then it gets kind of fun. So, yeah, just out there telling everyone thanks, one concerned citizen to another, and also feels good to be a part of it. Sort of a support group.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it. I know it is. It's always nerve-wracking walking up to that door because you really have no idea what you're going to encounter. Tip of the hat for you for doing that. Is this your first time in Wisconsin?
No, I had a brother graduate from University of Wisconsin, so I've been here. Got married here as well, so I've been here a few times.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, so. Are you like traveling all over the country doing this or just in swing states? You obviously feel very passionate about politics and this election in particular, as so many people do. What other states have you hit? And has there been a different reaction here or a different energy, so to speak?
I was just in Philadelphia yesterday. A similar enthusiasm, you know, similar jitters.
Yeah.
I think we're all feeling a lot of the same feelings. And it's, you know, it's somewhat, it's a blur to me a little bit, but it's been very heartening.
Well, that's good. Do people recognize you typically when you knock on their door?
No, not really. And that's probably as it should be.
That's good. That helps you get an honest assessment of what people are really talking about with you, and they're not starstruck or anything. So that's a good thing.
Yeah, I'm not trying to surprise anybody.
I just want to say this is fun for me because when I first moved to L.A., I did a lot of freelance writing, and you were on the Gilmore Girls several times, and that's one of the show I freelanced for the WB, writing promos and stuff. So you've added a bit to your you've added quite a bit to your resume since then. So congrats to you for that.
As have you. Congrats to you.
I had a lot of fun out there, and it was great. Sold some movies. Only one of them got made. Doing radio now. Absolutely love it. Love working for Civic Media, and it's great to reconnect with you, even though I didn't meet you back then. I was an admirer of your work. I loved.
It was fortuitous.
Yeah, exactly. We were destined to connect again at some point.
Yes, yes, yes.
Can you tell me, one of my favorite films is Promising Young Woman. You have such a memorable part in that movie, kind of got the ball rolling. Can you talk a little bit about your experience in that film?
Sure. It was, you know, Emerald Fennell, who wrote and directed it, is just a phenomenal talent. And that was obvious. And she's also a wonderful actress. And so she's very charismatic as well. And that was obvious from the script. I mean, everyone, you know, knew how good a script that was, and how good a movie it would be. And I think she did a wonderful job with it. And she also, you know, where I come in that particular one is, you know, a bit of a misdirect. And she cast a handful of people known for their nice guy personas, their nice guy roles, and subverted those. And I thought it was brilliant.
That's really fascinating what you said, because I don't think a lot of actors or people in general, when they work on a film, know it's going to be great. So the fact that you said that, did everybody feel like that on the set? Like they really felt like they had something special here?
Yes, I think so. I mean, the movie's very entertaining and funny. And yet, right. And then it has this showcase where a great part for Carey Mulligan, who was one of our finest actors, and then a procession of cameos and different great parts for a bunch of men and a few women as well. And like I said, it's funny, it's tense, and at the same time, while you're being entertained, it's very thought-provoking, it's very provocative, and it was talking and having a dialogue with a moment we were having and are still having. And so it was incredibly topical while not being preachy in any way. And so that's just a great cocktail.
That's a great answer. I have to say this phrase to you, and I want to get your reaction to it. Do you call it a sport coat in real life?
No. I know I said it on the show. I'm still a little confused. Which is which? What makes it a sport coat?
I don't know. What else would you call it? Honestly,
I guess, I mean, in the show, I had an example technically it's not because X, but I forget what the reasoning was. Right. I don't know.
My guest is Adam Brody. He is the star of the show Nobody Wants This. And we were talking to him a little bit about his role in Promising Young Woman and going back to the Gilmore Girls. But he is here in Wisconsin canvassing and trying to help get out the vote. There's a season 2 of Nobody Wants This, right? What I've seen of it so far, I'm a big fan. It's a great show.
Thanks a lot. We're very excited to make more. It's a lovely show to work on.
Yeah, it looks like it. What do you watch on TV when you're done filming your own stuff or canvassing or doing whatever you do for fun? What do you sit down and watch typically at night?
That's a fun question. I don't know that I have a typical thing. I really wish I watched more, but between bedtime for the kids and bedtime for me, you know, staying awake, and there's not all that much time. So I've been working my way through Long Legs, the Nicolas Cage horror movie.
Right.
I really enjoy it. It's you know, I don't watch that much horror because I'm not that interested. I mean, I'll be scared as a byproduct, but that's not why I'm going to something. I'll go to something because I think it's really clever or et cetera. And so, which this one is so stylish. So anyways, maybe I'm not the best judge, but I have to say, it is terrifying. It's terrifying. It's incredibly creepy. I really like it. But I've been working my way through that. I'm almost done. I'm doing it in pieces because I fall asleep.
I kind of do horror that way too, just because it's not my genre, but that's kind of a lot of what we talk about on this show is, well, all things entertainment, but movies and TV. You said you have kids. Do you have a favorite kids movie you could recommend to people, other listeners?
Oh, I would love to. Let me pitch a little kid book and movie that I love so much. It's very precious. I don't say it's an acquired taste, but no worries if you don't like it. It might not be for everyone. But Astrid Lindgren, who wrote Pippi Longstock. He wrote a book in like the early 80s called Ronya the Robber's Daughter. And it's a year in the life of this girl in medieval Europe who is coming of age. And it's so beautiful and adventurous, and it's sort of Huck Finn meets the Secret Garden. It's just like, but really innocent and really sweet. And then there's a, they did a cartoon series, and I believe it's on Amazon, a two-season series that really is just the book verbatim. And it's, I'm getting in the weeds here, but indulge me. But Miyazaki's son. Miyazaki is the great anime director from Japan that does Spirited Away and everything. His son directed all these. And it's two seasons and just does the book front to back on Amazon. It's got a great catchy little intro tune. And yeah, if you're looking for something peaceful for your kids, slower pace where you really, as anime often does, it really, you know, you like can hear the birds chirping in it and stuff. It's just, yeah, you want looking for something a little peaceful. I recommend the book followed by the show.
It's a nice alternative to Long Legs for sure. Adam, thank you so much for your time.
Hell of a thing to fall asleep to.
Yeah, right. The last thing you see before you go to sleep is Nicolas Cage looking like a woman and with weird makeup. It's horrifying.
Yeah, screaming.
So, well, listen, I can't thank you enough for your time today, Adam. Keep knocking on doors and getting out the vote. And welcome to Wisconsin. It's great to have you here. We're a great state. And hopefully we all show up at the polls. And we have you in part to thank for it. Yeah. So thank you so much.
Let me say one thing, if I may. To anyone listening, couple things about voting. Give me just 30 seconds of your time.
Absolutely. One, yeah, go for it.
Vote early. It's too late to convince you who to vote for, but vote early because if you're planning to vote on election day, there's a bunch of reasons why that might not happen. You might have COVID. You might go and there's too long a line and you go somewhere else and you don't get back in time. If you vote early by going to a polling place and now and filling out an early ballot and dropping it, or taking your mail-in ballot and dropping it off at an early or at a polling station now, that works. Number two. This is the most pivot, I believe, with every fiber of my being, this is the most pivotal election of our lifetimes. We'll be talking about it for the rest of our lives. It is that historic. We have that stark a choice. And you're going to remember this week for the rest of your life. There's only a week left. So if you can, knock on some doors, volunteer in any way, because I promise you, you'll remember where you were and what you did in 50 years.
That is very well said, my friend. All right. Well, have a safe trip. Thanks so much for being here and visiting us here in Wisconsin. It was great to get to know you a little bit. And keep up the great work. We're following.
All right. I appreciate it. Thanks a lot. Talk to you soon.
All right. Thanks, Adam.
There's a problem with every sign. Bargain buildings, weights and pulleys, feathers.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Conrad, I just want to say that was very good. That was very good Adam Brody outro music. The perfect music to the end of an interview with Adam Brody, in my opinion.
I just think that's a great song overall.
It is a great song.
It goes good with anything.
That's true. You kind of qualified my compliment. That's okay. he was fun. That was a fun interview. He's a good guy to talk to. And it was weird because I woke up yesterday morning and my niece sent this picture out of her next to Adam Brody to the whole family. And I was like, I didn't know. She didn't say who it was. She just said my canvassing partner. And I said, I think that's the guy I'm interviewing today at 3 o'clock. So it's just one of those things. But that was fun. All right. So our question tonight, ladies and gentlemen, is what is your favorite animated film or TV show? You can pick old cartoons, new stuff, either way, but we've gotten some great texts. Jim from Appleton, we're a little behind here, so I'm going to try to get through these because they're great. Jim from Appleton says, Samurai Jack was a great show. Do you remember that, Conrad?
Yes, actually, that was one of my favorite childhood cartoons. Yeah, okay. It was on Disney, I believe, so yeah, that was a good show.
Okay, Well done, Jim, as usual. And then somehow we spiraled off into this generation talk about what generation starts when, and there are many different theories. But Carmela from Milwaukee, from the 414, shared, she said, Pete, here is an article listing all the generations and years they are associated with. It's called What Generation Am I? A Guide to the Seven Generation Names and Years. And that's from Good Housekeeping. So I would think if you keep a tidy house, you'd have a pretty good beat on that kind of stuff. So thank you, Carmela, for sharing that. Jim from Appleton also says, I was born in 1961 to a Korean War veteran father. I'm a cusper between Boomer and Gen X. And I could be wrong. We should probably consult the book Carmela told us about, but I think that's Boomer, Jim. At least to some. I don't know. Don't listen to me. Annie from Watertown says, the question is, were there any labels for generations before the self-important boomers? She says, yes, ahem, we're very important. So Annie is identifying as a boomer. Good for you, Annie. Hannah from from Milwaukee says, favorite animated show, Home Movies. And I don't know if that's a play on words, like, because in Home Movies, people are very animated, or if that's a show I'm unaware of. But Anna continues saying, underrated Adult Swim show from the late 90s. Oh, she's explaining from the same team behind Bob's Burgers. Okay, so Home Movies, you and I were talking about this, Conrad. That is a show. I was totally unfamiliar with that. But it's by the same people who made Bob's Burgers. A friend of mine writes for Bob Burgers, John Schrader, great guy, 6 feet, 10 inches tall, very humongous individual. You wouldn't think would be as funny as he is, but he's hilarious. I don't know why you wouldn't. It makes me sound like I'm discriminating against tall people. It's terrible. But Hannah says, so many good characters and quotable lines. And again, if you guys are fans of Futurama, King of the Hill, shows like Bob Burgers, I have a great guest Monday night. Mike Rowe will be here talking. He was a former comedian out of New York who went on to write very successfully for several shows like Futurama and King of the Hill. He'll be here Monday talking about a book. And we'll talk about a lot of these shows that you guys are bringing up. Jim from Appleton says, where they end up is up for debate. I personally put the end at 1960 through 1963. He's talking about the boomers. Annie from Watertown says, boomers are either 1960 or 1962. And then Annie from Watertown, it sounds like she's had enough. She says, WTF, use guys. According to Phil Dunphy on Modern Family, that means why the face, WTF. But WTF, we all know what it means. She says, baby boomers, the baby boomers after World War II. Yes, of course, Annie. Lower your voice. All right, so great text. Keep them coming. Let us know. You could weigh in on baby boomers, Gen X, whatever, or your favorite animated show. Ross from Crawford County says, Walt Disney's 1940 Fantasia, a classic. Very well done, Ross. These are great texts. Keep them coming, folks. Let's ask our next guests what their favorite animated show is. They are here in studio, and they drove in all the way from Green Bay, Wisconsin, representing the Brown County Historical Society, who has a big event tomorrow night here in Brown County, the 125th Anniversary Gala event. And you guys are here to talk about that. It's Dierdra and Steven Stary. You guys are either a married couple or brother and sister. Yeah. Or depending on where you are, both. I don't know. Okay. Married couple. Lovely. Yeah. Nice to meet both of you. Thanks for being here.
Nice to meet you, too.
Do you guys have a favorite animated show?
Prodigy.
Yeah,
Star Trek. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I am not a Trekkie. I don't know a lot of the... You just did that. You did not just do that. Is that Spock?
Yeah. Okay. The Vulcan salute. Yes.
The Vulcan salute.
I thought you were going to say Lower Decks.
Oh, I love Lower Decks, too. That's really good.
What about you, Steve?
I'm gonna go with Robotech.
Yes. Wow, this is above my pay grade. The shows a lot of people are mentioning, like Home Movies with Hannah. I didn't even know what that was, and I haven't heard of that. What is that?
Well, it's originally an anime from Japan.
Okay,
three different series, and they mushed them together and created a storyline for it.
Oh, very nice.
The giant robots fighting aliens kind of genre.
Oh, that old genre. Yeah. Okay. I love it. That's great. Thank you for playing along. So are you guys baby boomers? Do you know when that whole thing started, or are you Gen X?
We're Gen X.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm total slacker here.
So you were born in the mid-60s-ish, mid to late?
Early 70s.
Early 70s. Yeah. Okay, you're definitely Gen X. Okay. Yeah. Conrad, what are you, by the way? I don't mean to label
even,
you, but...
I don't even remember. What's 25? I'll have to look it up. I don't
really... Why don't you do... Let's do that, and then after the news, you can tell us who you okay. are, because I don't want you to be a man without a generation that's been labeled. Probably like the Conrad generation.
Oh, I know. I was born in 1999, so...
Okay.
I was born just out of 2000.
We need more information than that. all right. It's great to have you guys here. We're going to talk about this event. It's tomorrow night. Let me ask you first, before we go do the news, then we'll come back and get into the inside stuff, but are there still tickets available?
I think the deadline for that has passed, unfortunately.
Oh, no.
Yeah, we had to get our dinner count in a while back.
Oh, so can people crash it? Are you going to turn people away?
I'm not authorized to answer that question.
Okay.
We'll tell you where it is and when it starts, and I don't know if we have bouncers or anything like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I was gonna bring Conrad as my plus one, but if it's not gonna happen,
we're not really the kind of organization that has bouncers and turns people away. I mean, like it's a fundraising event, so if I just don't know if there's enough food for everybody.
It'll just be that awkward thing where you see two people that probably shouldn't be there, and everybody's just whispering, but nobody really wants to take the next step and throw them out.
No, we're gonna welcome you, and then you're gonna make you a volunteer.
You're going to put us to work?
Yeah.
Deal's off, Conrad. We're going to sit this one
see,
out.
See, that's all right. What you had to do. Tell him he's going to be a volunteer.
Tell him you have to actually do something. Yeah. All right. Dierdra and Steven Stary are here from the Brown County Historical Society. We're going to jump into their big event tomorrow night and some cool Brown County history. I hope they're prepared because I have questions. It'll be fun. They're here in studio. Great to have them. And we'll talk more with them after. Civic Media's award-winning news team keeps you informed. This is Pete Schwaba and Nite Lite on the Civic Media Radio Network. Until I meet the dog, Mrs. Princess, who often wonder what makes her work. I guess I'll leave that question to the experts. Assuming that there are some out there, they're probably alone. Solitaire. I can remember when I caught up with a pet. You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. heroicdeed.com. You've seen her dressed in blue. See the sky in front of you. And her face is like a sail. Why so fair and pale? Bridget from the 818 says The Simpsons. Same as me, Bridget. Great minds think alike. I love The Simpsons. Conrad picked, what is it again?
Family Guy. For the cartoon series. Okay. But if it was a movie, it'd be Puss in Boots.
Puss in Boots, okay. Oh, Dierdra approves.
Yeah.
You like Puss in Boots?
I
yeah.
do.
All right. So my guest right now in studio, this is very exciting, Dierdra and Steven Stary. They're board members of the Green Bay Historical Society. Tell us about this really cool event tomorrow night that none of us can apparently go to. it's the Brown County Historical Society's 125th Anniversary Gala from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. tomorrow night. What is going to happen there? And tell us about something in particular you're celebrating.
Well, we're celebrating. We've been a historical society for 125 years. That's why we called it the 125th Anniversary
yeah.
Gala. I know. Sometimes the naming just works
out. You labor that over that title? Or
yeah.
That...
No, it just kind of came to us. Anyway, so we decided to celebrate by having a gala at Gather on Broadway. And we're going to do a dinner and a guest speaker, Cliff Crystal, Green Bay Packers historian, is going to talk.
Oh.
And we've asked him to kind of focus on kind of the lesser known things, you know, the kind of the oddball tidbits, maybe
Love
stuff
it.
From early Packers history. I've played a couple of Packer related people at the cemetery walks over the last couple of years. So I've kind of noticed some of these oddball things too. And I'm like, I want to hear from the expert what he has to say about Johnny Blood riding, you know, like a hobo to get to town, you know, for training camp or, you know.
Is that a real thing?
That's what I read. So I don't
know.
His
name was Johnny Blood?
No, not really. But okay. He chose it as a nickname.
It was really Turdell Middleton, wasn't it? He hopped on a hobo and yeah. Wow. That's a crazy story. Yeah. I want to talk about this. You guys have a really cool event, a cemetery walk. We'll get into that too. Mm-hmm. But for those of us who aren't, you know, I think everybody just associates Green Bay with the Packers. They're a worldwide brand and they're a great thing for a city this size, but there's a whole other history in this city that's pretty fascinating. Can you tell us a couple, for those of us who don't know or aren't in tune with Green Bay history or who have never lived here, and we're on all over the state, tell us something fascinating about Green Bay's history.
My goodness, there's so much of it. Where to even begin?
You've got 12 seconds. No.
Martin in his entire life, he helped build Wisconsin. He helped build Green Bay. His whole family kept Green Bay going, and they actually started the Green Bay Historical Society, which is now the Brown County Historical Society.
We preserve their house. That's Hazelwood. That's our headquarters. That's our historic home museum. But we're more than just that. So the European settlement of Wisconsin goes back to 1634. So we've got almost, 400 years of history that we can talk about. You're going to have to narrow it down a little.
All right. Let's talk about how the Packers did in 1634. They just missed the playoffs.
Yeah.
but they rallied the next year and got a wild card. Hazelwood. All right. Yeah. Tell us about Heritage Hill, too. I took my kids there about 6 years ago. But I was on the phone the entire time because I had this business thing happening, and I felt like I really missed out on something. So I cheated myself out of Heritage Hill knowledge. So would you, for my own personal sake, tell me what happened at Heritage Hill and why it's such a great attraction?
Okay. Well, this actually fits in with what the Brown County Historical Society does, because we created Heritage Hill. Our founders recognized a need to preserve historic buildings, such as the Fort Howard buildings. And by the time they had assembled in 1899 as a historical society, those buildings were starting to be moved to other locations. Some of them, their purpose was forgotten, turned into private homes. Some of them were being torn down. So our founders said, we're going to preserve these however we can. And decades later, when the state was giving up half of the prison in Alloway, the land that Heritage Hill is on was the prison farm.
Oh, yeah.
When they decided to put in Highway 172, that land that the state still owned, the Historical Society said, hey, now, wait a second, we can do something with that. We've already got the cotton house at the top of the hill. Let's move the other historic buildings there and make it a state park. Decades worth of negotiations later, and now they're their own entity, so they're a separate organization, but we try to cooperate a lot.
Yeah. All right. So you kind of just told me, but in a more succinct or straightforward answer, and tell us what, or the listeners, what exactly does the Brown County Historical Society do? Do you guys see something that you can help promote Green Bay and its history, try to get grants, try to appeal to the state to make it a historical site? Is that a ton of work? Is it an uphill struggle every time?
Yes. In fact, all of the things that you mentioned are things that we have done and that we do. So preserving the historic buildings, moving some of them to Heritage Hill back before, we'll help other people who want to do like historic renovations. We don't have, an extensive library of that, but we can get you in touch with the people who do. People call us all the time and ask, hey, what about this historic site? What about, historic renovation for my home? Can you point me in the right direction? So we're a place that they ask. The local history department at the library, Mary Jane and Dennis and the rest. So we help with that. We get grants to try to preserve our own home, Hazelwood, and that sort of thing.
And how difficult is that? Like you just said, your own, like that's your headquarters, Hazelwood.
Yeah.
Is that, who helps you out with that? Is it all local or do you have to go to the state? Do you go to the federal government? Like what?
It depends on the grant. Okay. We have a fantastic executive director, Christine Dunbar, who writes the grants. She does all the networking between the State Historical Society and us and the grant people. And then she follows through on the criteria for each grant and makes sure that we fit the criteria. And she writes it very, very well. And we actually just received a grant to do some renovation on the house.
Nice. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So tomorrow night, you're having this gala event. Are most of the people like a bunch of history buffs, but you're going to kick off your shoes tomorrow night and go nuts and do the Macarena and break dance and all that kind of stuff? Like what's going to happen tomorrow night?
I don't know if we have a DJ or anything like that. That would
no,
be fun.
But we have the mayor coming to issue us a proclamation for our 125th. That. And we're going to have the speaker talking about the unique Packer history. We have my sister's actually going to be doing some photography against an old backdrop from our digital archives group. And so you're going to get your picture taken in front of that backdrop. And we'll have a wee little silent auction for some pictures again from the digital archives group. And see how much fun that is.
That sounds like a lot of fun, actually. You talked about the mayor. He's going to give a proclamation. What's he going to proclamate?
I think he's just going to congratulate us on having stuck around for 125 years. Yeah. It's kind of fitting because 125 years ago, it was the important people, you know, mayors and former mayors, Arthur and Ellen Neville, yeah. Nothing around here named after them.
No, Debbie Martin, Sarah Martin.
They were the founders.
The Beaumonts, I believe. Yeah, there's a lot of famous names that we have around here, and buildings and things actually started us all those years ago.
All right, so let's get to the really fun stuff that you hinted at, Stephen. Mm-hmm. I told you during the break that our guest last week, Frank Anderson, was telling creepy stories on our last Freaky Friday segment, and he said that Washington Street, where WGBW, where we are right now, is haunted, and it was paved over burial grounds. Mm-hmm. What can you tell us about that?
Well, I know that the original French settlement was a little bit further down Washington Street, right about where Adams Street and Washington come together, right where Firehouse Number 1 is, right by Mason Street Bridge. And so the original French cemetery would have been there, too. And when those bodies were moved, and they're in a mass grave at Alloway Catholic Cemetery, I can tell you where that is, too. I mean, the mass grave, not just the cemetery.
Right.
They didn't get everybody because some of those had been, you know, and the wooden markers were all deteriorated, so you didn't know where all the bodies were. Same thing happens up on Webster and Mason Street. That Baird place used to be the city cemetery until Woodlawn opened, and they moved all the bodies, and again, they didn't get
all of
them.
How do they know they didn't get all of them?
Because occasionally they'll do public works projects and find more parts.
Dear. Wow, really?
That's how you get hauntings.
Do you believe Washington Street here is haunted?
I don't know that I'd want to spend the night in the fire station.
Do you know? But those guys do, right?
Well, they don't really have a choice, do they?
No, but they have hoses. And they can. So have you ever experienced anything, any kind of haunting about on Washington Street or in Green Bay in general?
You want to tell them about Cotton House, Steve?
Oh, yeah. Bring it.
Yeah. So supposedly... Beaupré Place or Cotton House was haunted, and a lot of people have said that they have had, if they never say good morning to Priscilla, their whole day is ruined. She will find a way to make it go wrong. And I had one instance where I forgot to say good morning because I had people right there as I opened up, and sure enough, I had fallen over and trip right in front of the guests, and finally when they were gone I said, okay Priscilla, good morning, and then the day went just fine after that.
And then she helped you up and
no, not that, but I knew she was there. But yeah, they always say that she's up there with doing her perfume bottle or something else like that, but I don't think it's ever been founded.
And you attribute that to Priscilla.
I do.
Have you ever tripped without the help of a ghost?
No.
No.
Are you sure? There you go. Are you sure about that?
Yeah, your husband's sitting right there.
Maybe once.
That's really crazy that they would not take some of the bodies. This seems like a recipe for disaster.
They try their best, but if the graves aren't marked anymore, you know, even in cemeteries, you can see that the oldest stones are already deteriorating. That's stones. If they were just wooden markers.
You don't think it's a guy who skipped breakfast and was just a little over hungry and went to lunch a little early and said, you know, I can leave a couple of them here.
No, they just buried some bodies that had been from the Baird Place Cemetery, and they found them decades ago, and they've been sitting on a shelf at the Neville Museum until just recently. They finally arranged to bury them at Woodlawn Cemetery this summer.
Wait, the bodies were at the...
Just the bones, what's left of them, yeah.
Oh, okay.
They couldn't find any DNA relatives, so they just buried them at Woodlawn.
Wow. All right. I guess I believe you. I have no reason not to believe you. You know, a historian is like fact-based, right? You guys are kind of historians, and you're, you know, take this pretty seriously, I would assume.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Have any of the firefighters ever said anything?
You should have David Siegel on sometime. Yes. He's the one who's done the whole history of the Green Bay Fire Department.
Yeah.
And what else is there besides the besides that? Is there, they have a colorful history?
Yeah, he also talks about a lot of the big fires that happened in Green Bay.
Okay.
And
oh,
how
great.
Those fires shaped the firefighters and the firefighter code and their SOPs and things like that that they do nowadays.
Okay.
He's also been a docent for us at some of the cemeteries, cemetery walks. He's just a fantastic wealth of knowledge.
Wow, very cool. I will definitely take you up on that. So you also do, in keeping with our Halloween theme, a couple more days here, you have a feature called Stories from Beyond the Grave. Can you share those?
Sure. Usually these are adaptations of our cemetery walk scripts. So three times a year we do a cemetery walk, Fort Howard Cemetery, Alloway Catholic Cemetery, Woodlawn Cemetery. And we have six or seven different stops, and an actor plays the part of the person buried there, somebody with an interesting story. I've played a number of roles over the years. We've been doing this for almost 20, 25 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, just there are some interesting people that have lived in the past, and you just don't know it because we're always so focused on the present.
Mm-hmm. Who have you played?
Oh,
you play someone like that comes out of the grave
Nathan
or whatever?
Abrams, you've played.
I played Nathan Abrams a couple of years ago. He was one of the original 1919 Green Bay Packers.
Is he the guy they named the Abrams split after on Highway 41?
No, unfortunately.
Seems like kind of a
Abrams
chip.
Is named for a former mayor, actually.
Oh.
But no, he was a Jewish Packer player.
Okay.
And a friend, childhood friend of Curly Lambeau's.
Oh.
And so he was on the original team. He has one touchdown. In the official NFL
records.
That's
one more than me.
An interception that he ran back for a touchdown, and the Packers were already ahead, so they didn't need it. But I know that stat. I played George Dallaire, the founder of the Packers Lumberjack Band. My favorite one, though, is actually an ancestor of mine, Dennis Murphy, a Civil War hero.
Let's pick up there.
Sir?
We got to do a quick thing, because I'm half Murphy, so I want to hear this.
Oh, all right.
Maybe we're related somehow. I don't know. All right. Steven and Dierdra Stary are here from the Brown County Historical Society. We'll have a couple minutes left with them when we get back and help us wrap this show up. This is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Tomorrow night on Nite Lite, I will be joined by Tim McCormick from the Harley-Davidson Museum. They are celebrating their 115th anniversary coming up, and Wisconsin comedian Dobie Maxwell will be here as well. Steady Eddie, also known as Steadfast Edward, has decided to get his text in a little earlier tonight than usual. He says, Pete, baby boomers, 46 to 64. That's what I thought, Steadfast. 1964, the last year U.S. dimes, quarters, half dollars were made with 90% silver. You could buy a Hershey bar for a nickel. Wow, there's some history for you, huh? I can't pick a favorite animated show. Depends on how I'm feeling. I like King of the Hill on Fridays, The Simpsons on Thursdays, and Sundays, and Bugs Bunny any day ending in Y. Steady Eddie. Love it. I love Steady Eddie's text. What would you go with, Steady Eddie or Steadfast Edward?
Ooh.
It's a tough one.
You'd go Steady Eddie. I'd go Steadfast Edward. I'd just make all those syllables get pronounced.
All right, you were in the middle of telling us about a gentleman named Murphy.
Yes.
Who I felt a connection to because I'm half Murphy. Please continue.
All right. Well, Dennis Murphy, he was an immigrant from Ireland, came over because of the famine, of course. He was 30 years old, married, had kids, was a farmer. And when the Civil War broke out, he said, I'm a good Irishman. I can't let family get in the way of getting into a good fight.
Okay.
So he signed up, volunteered, and he was at the Battle of Shiloh. He kind of distinguished himself there. His regiment captured the same Confederate cannons like three different times, had to give them up. And then the third time they captured them, they stayed captured. And they're the ones that are down at Camp Randall.
Oh, no kidding. I was going to ask. Okay.
And
that's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, and the State Veterans Museum has those cannons, too. And at the Battle of Corinth, he carried the flag for his regiment and was wounded four times. The flag is at the State Historical Society, so you can go and, you know, see it. I mean, it's like conserved someplace. Yeah. But they awarded him the Congressional Medal of Honor for his actions.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And I would hate to be you see those pictures, there's two guys carrying muskets, one guy banging a drum and another guy carrying a flag. Those guys are more brave than the guys carrying the musket. You're just out there like a sitting duck carrying the flag. Talk about drawing the low straw, right? Yeah. I mean, or playing the drum. Mm-hmm.
He said going into the Battle of Corinth, he said, I'm either coming out of this a live lieutenant or a dead sergeant.
That Murphy sounds like a real character. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, so Dierdra, you're going to tell us about the cemetery walks that the Historical Society here in Brown County offers.
Yeah, so like my husband said, three times a year we do Fort Howard, Alloway, and then Woodlawn. And basically you join a group of about 20 to 25 people, and you go around and you visit about 6 to 7 different people that actors are playing that are buried there at the cemetery, and you get to hear about their life. And we've had some amazing actors and stories. We had a couple murderers that were on the tour. We had a couple family men. We have a couple politicians. We've had people that founded Green Bay and helped start the town. We've had farmers and
I played a Brown County sheriff who during Prohibition became a bootlegger.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we've had bootleggers and sheriffs and cops and stuff.
What did you do to research that role, Stephen?
Oh, gosh. Well, always start with the local history department at the library. Mary Jane Herber and Dennis Jacobs, they are very helpful. You go through the obituaries, the newspaper articles about them. If you're lucky, they've got more than just an obituary about them. The Area Research Center out at UWGB is very helpful. I mean, we've got the resources for local history.
I was just asking to see if you said I went out and got drunk and bought a sheriff's uniform. That's what I was thinking. You went into the whole actual, like, actually doing your homework, which is impressive.
It's what we do.
All right. So please continue, Dierdra.
Yeah, so for about 2 hours, you just walk the cemetery and you get to learn about other people's lives in the years that they were alive and realize they had 24 hours, you have 24 hours, and how do we use our hours wisely? And it's a neat way to show relativity
in the
lives and meet people. And it's just a fantastic
and way to learn about history, too,
which is
what you guys are all about.
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
yeah,
that's so cool.
Education and preserving history, yeah.
Are you guys both lifelong Green Bay residents?
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice. So tell me the best thing about living in Green Bay.
The cheese.
Really? Is the cheese here better than the cheese in Menasha?
I just like the cheese.
Well, it's definitely better than other states.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. What about you, Steven?
Oh, gosh. I don't know. I think it's a good location. I think it's, you know, the climate. I like having all four seasons.
Okay.
And in Green Bay, you can have them all in one day sometimes.
Correct. Sadly. Those are great answers, though. That's nice. And it's just home, right? Yeah. So good for you. All right. So now it's the moment of truth. What are you watching on TV, Dierdra? What do you like to watch?
Currently, we're trying to get through the next season of Lincoln Lawyer, but I also
just finished it.
Oh,
loved
is it good?
It's good. Yeah.
There's a
the
connection
show
at the end with his defendant. I know there is, but So then the other things we like are the PBS shows, the mysteries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they do a
and
good
Finding
job.
Your Roots. Oh, love that show. Again, nice. Mystery.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, and the British Baking Show.
Yes.
That got us through COVID.
It did.
Yeah.
All right.
I have a killer five Wisconsin cheese sourdough right now.
That's a very well-rounded TV list. Thank you guys so much for coming in and being here in person. It's been great to meet you guys. And
Thank you.
At your event tomorrow. Next year, give us some warning and we'll all buy tickets and we'll crash. It'll be fun.
All right. Sounds good.
All right. That's Dierdra and Steven Stary from the Brown County Historical Society. And I'd also like to thank my other guests, Ian Teal from the Waiwege International Film Festival. Check it out. November 13th through the 16th. And actor Adam Brody, who was nice enough to spend some time with me yesterday that we played a little bit earlier. Join me tomorrow night. Folks, we're going to be back here doing this all again tomorrow night. It's what we do from 6 to 8 every night. On behalf of the lovable producer, Conrad, I'm Pete Schwaba. This has been Nite Lite on the Civic Media Radio Network. Good night, Wisconsin.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.